Jesus, work in the rain, spreading the gospel, we'll never complain. Though the days may grow long, we'll strive harder to be all the cowboys for Jesus should be. On the wide open prairie, through the day and the night, we'll carry the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Like the clear stars in heaven, or the desert so bright, we'll have a roundup with the gospel of light.
I used to sing a lot with quartet groups. Here's a quartet song, minus three.
Once I was lost in sin, I had no peace within. To save my weary soul, I knew not how. But Jesus came to me, and by his grace I'm free. Now it's different, yes, it's oh so different now. It's different now since Jesus saved my soul. It's different now since by his blood I'm whole. Old Satan had to flee when Jesus rescued me. Now it's different, yes, it's oh so different now. I went to church one day to hear them sing and pray. The preacher firmly plowed the gospel plow. He said, you must repent. So down the aisle I went. Now it's different, yes, it's oh so different now. It's different now since Jesus saved my soul. It's different now since by his blood I'm whole. Old Satan had to flee when Jesus rescued me. Now it's different, yes, it's oh so different now. And now my hopes are bright. I praise him day and night. How he could change me so I knew not how. But praise the Lord, it's done. The victory now is won. Now it's different, yes, it's oh so different now. It's different now since Jesus saved my soul. It's different now since by his blood I'm whole. Old Satan had to flee when Jesus rescued me. Now it's different, yes, it's oh so different now.
Different now. Well, this is what we're here for tonight. Are you tired of chasing pretty rainbows? Are you tired of spinning round and round? Wrap up all the shattered dreams of your life and at the feet of Jesus lay them down. Give them all, give them all, give them all to Jesus. Shattered dreams, wounded hearts, and broken toys. Give them all, give them all, give them all to Jesus, and he will turn your sorrow into joy. He never said you'd only see sunshine. He never said there'd be no rain. He only promised a heart full of singing about the very things that once brought pain. Give them all, give them all,
give them all to Jesus. Shattered dreams, wounded hearts, and broken toys. Give them all, give them all, give them all to Jesus, and He will turn your sorrows into joy.
Well, I'm glad y'all are here this evening. We're going to have a good time tonight. Little Wranglers. We got Little Wranglers everywhere. Right up there in that room, right up there, they'll have a wonderful time. They've got a good teacher. If y'all want them to go, I know they would enjoy it. Anybody else? Folks, we got buckets at each and every one of these doors. That's for your tithes and your offerings and your donations. We utilize that to pay what bills we need to pay and help folks out and just for the glory of God is what we utilize it for. Now, we got a lot of hot air blowing around in here every now and then. So we put lids on them and put a groove in it so the money will quit blowing out of there. You see what I mean? So just stick it in that slot there in the top of it. It'll go down the bottom. We can get it out of there because they come out. So anyway, men's Bible study. Right up there in that same room where the little Wranglers just went. We're a little bit bigger than they are, but we studied the same Bible and learned the same things. And we have a good teacher, and we have a lot of fun up there. So you guys that get off early in the morning or don't work or go to work late, y'all are certainly welcome to come up there, and we have some coffee and fellowship and just study the Word. We want to thank the Mason family for allowing us to use these facilities. These are wonderful facilities, and they allow us to use these facilities for absolutely no rental cost at all. Now, folks, that's nice. That's a blessing. Annie Mason will open the cafe back up come, I guess, when school starts, I think is what she told me. So y'all keep that in mind. Next week, we'll have, July the 28th, we'll have Jack Stone. He's out of where? Muleshoe, Texas. August the 4th, we'll have Gene Morgan. August 11th, we'll have Rosie O'Toole. August the 18th, Wade White. August 25th, Jeannie Engel. September the 1st, Dusty Allman. September the 8th, Rough Cuts. September the 15th, Doris Merritt. September the 22nd, Bobby Bond Family. And September the 29th, Barry Ward. So we've got a good lineup coming up. Y'all keep that in your mind and bring somebody with you every week. We'd appreciate seeing them, and I'm sure they would enjoy it. Got lots of prayer requests. Leon Gilbert went to Oklahoma City today to get his batteries changed in his pacemaker. They told him he has to stay all night, so he'll be back, should be sometime tomorrow.
They got home
already? Praise the Lord. There you go. So that, God works good. Anyway, they told him he had to stay all night, but evidently he did it really, it went real well. Caleb Phipps. David and Jan's grandson. It's got some problems. He's got cancer. 16-year-old. It's a horrible thing for a big young man. Y'all keep him in your prayers every day. Just that God will heal him and just clear him from that. Now his I guess it's his mother that made the blog. Okay, she made a blog that you can keep up with his treatment and all that's going on. I laid a copy of it. The address out on the table out there. Please don't take the address, just copy it down. And you can put that in your phone or your computer or whatever, and you can keep up with that blog on what is going on as far as treatment and how it's progressing and all that. Now, that's a good thing. But y'all keep him in your prayers all the time. Joe Lightfield still needs our prayers. Ron is here, looking good too, isn't he? Y'all give Ron a hand. He's been through it. And he's here tonight. Good to see you, Ron. Pray for our country, our leaders. I don't know what else to say about that. Just pray for them. Pray for them every day. Pray hard that the Lord knows what he's doing. He's still in control. I mean, sometimes we think, I don't know how, but we don't know what he's got in store for us. But y'all keep your leaders in your prayers and those that want to be leaders. There's a six-month-old Mason Boone. He will have open heart surgery Tuesday, 7/26. That's next Tuesday. Y'all keep him in your prayer. He's 6 months old. That's a little bitty baby to have open heart surgery. So be sure and keep him in your prayers. Bud Simpson says he's an old cowboy. I don't know how old, but old cowboy. Went into St. Mary's Hospital, woke up with slurred speech, blurred vision, possible infection in his gallbladder or something. I pray that they'll figure that out and get him fixed up pretty quick. And Jerry Borso, is that right, Borso? Is waiting for a heart valve that will fit in his heart. And he has cirrhosis of the liver. He also has had a stroke. Priests pray that his heart will hold until he gets the valve replacement. That's Linda Falvel's brother-in-law. So y'all keep them in your prayers. All right, how about right over here? Prayer requests, praise reports, birthdays, anniversaries, something we need to know about.
My friend Marcia that I had you praying for, she passed away Monday evening, and her funeral's going to be tomorrow. So remember the Schmidt family.
Okay.
We have a praise report. We have a lot of our family here tonight. Everybody in this row is part of our family.
Yeah.
We won't be here next week, so I'll go ahead and announce this now. On Wednesday, August the 3rd, I'm going to be having a test at St. Mary's Hospital. I've been having some problems with my throat for a while, and it's eroded away my vocal cords and damaged them at this point, so we're going to see what kind of treatment we need to do.
And August 2nd, it'll be, 30 years since an old cowboy preacher. Of course, he didn't look much like a cowboy back then. He wore a suit and stuff, married Tracy and I. So it'll be 30 years for our anniversary next Tuesday.
Happy anniversary.
My little sister, Debbie, that's usually here, she's off celebrating her 30th anniversary.
Wedding 30th anniversary.
Happy anniversary, baby.
Thanks for the prayers for our daughter Jane. She's out of the hospital now, but she has rods and bolts and nuts in her head, I guess, from the broken neck. So she's doing lots better. Thank you a lot.
Yeah. All righty. I've seen somebody over here. There.
I've got three praises. My health's doing better. We got our house taken care of out there in the country. And this Sunday, Teresa and I will be married 24 years.
Wow. Rex, would you pray, come pray for us?
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for what all you do for us. We pray that you be with us here tonight. We pray that you go and be with each and every one of us as usual. And all these prayer requests, and there's many more that's not mentioned here, we appreciate if you would help with them. And we pray for our leaders, and we pray we get the right one, and all the rest of them, and pray for our troops that makes it possible for us to be here. And in Jesus' name, amen.
Father, we do thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for your love. Father, we know that you heard each and every one of these prayer requests. We just ask that your perfect will be done in each and every one of them. Lord, they're all different. They go from little bitty babies on up, Father, but we know that you know that. We just ask you to bless them. Bless this cowboy church. Bless everything that we do, Lord, and let it be a blessing to you and blessing to this community. Lord, I ask you to bless every church in America, wherever it may be, that the word will go forth again this weekend, just like it does every weekend, Father, and that people will come back to you. In Jesus' precious name we ask. Amen. Miss Rosie.
He said, if I be lifted.
nail-scarred hands that bled for me. I touched the hem of his garment that fell round him there. My life, my heart I gave, my soul was in his care. Aren't you glad he's still got our hand, our soul in his care? He don't miss a one of us. He loves us. When I awoke, my heart beat so, and on my face the tears did flow. This was no dream. I knelt to pray, and again I heard my Savior say, he said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men to me. He turned and then I saw the nail-scarred hands that bled for me. I touched the hem of his garment that fell round him there. My life, my heart I gave, my soul was in his care. My life, my heart I gave, my soul was in his care. Thank you, Jesus.
Gospel of John, chapter 12. Beginning in verse number 20. It says, and there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. The same came there for to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired of him, saying, sir, we would see Jesus. What powerful words. We would see Jesus. Verse 22 says, Philip cometh and telleth Andrew. And again, Andrew and Philip telleth Jesus. It's a little bit unusual, I guess, to have Greeks coming to him wanting to see Jesus. So Philip, I guess, wasn't sure what to do. I'm not sure what happened there. And Jesus answered them, saying, the hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. He that loveth his life shall lose it. He that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there shall also my servants be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Now, folks, this event was taking place right after Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead. The Passover was fixing to happen. It was coming up. And people were coming in from all over for the Passover. Now, many of the folks that were coming in wanted to see Lazarus alive. They'd heard of Lazarus, or they knew Lazarus. They wanted to see him alive and meet Jesus because they had heard of the miracles that he had done and his raising of Lazarus from the dead. The chief priests were beginning to realize that many of these Jews that were around were beginning to believe in Jesus during that time period because of the miracles he had been doing. Of course, Jesus knew that his earthly ministry was fixing to come to a close, and he was going to be crucified. He knew that he was the lamb without spot or blemish. He knew that he was the lamb that would be slain for all of mankind. He knew that all along. Now, in verse number 24, we see where Jesus compared himself to a grain of wheat as an example of what was going to happen. He was talking about the grain of wheat that is sown into the ground. You farmers know all this. It lays there and it decomposes a little in the ground. Then one day it starts to rise up out of that ground. That little green shoot just starts rising up out of that ground. From that little sprout comes an abundance of fruit, though. This year they certainly made an abundance of fruit, didn't they? It comes up out of that ground as a little bitty twig, and then it just comes right on out. But he must die. Christ knew that he must die so that we might live. That's what he was trying to tell us. Through his death, burial, and resurrection, he would pay the price for all the sins of all mankind. Not just part of us, all mankind. So that through belief on him, salvation would be available to all, to every one of us. In verse 25 and 26, Jesus applied that to us. In order to follow him, we must die to sin. Ask forgiveness for our sins, die to it. But the rewards were truly everlasting for each one of us that did that. It is interesting to learn, to know that I looked. We don't know what happened with these two Greek fellows, whatever the how many there was. Bible doesn't tell us whether they ever even saw Jesus or not. I suspect that they did, but the Bible doesn't tell us that. It just doesn't mention them anymore. But I know that he's told us that whosoever cometh to him, he'll no wise cast out. So I suspect they talked to him, don't you? So, but this does appear to be a turning point in Jesus' ministry. Up to this point, there seemed to be always a repeated theme in the Gospel of John. Here it is. In John chapter 2, at the marriage in Cana of Galilee, the mother of Jesus told him that they were out of wine. In verse number 4, he told her, he said, his hour has not come yet. He said, I'm not come yet. In John chapter 7, there's a story where his brothers, who did not believe in him at this time, told him to go into Judea and show himself to the world. He said, well, go show the world who you are and what you can do. And John 7:6, Jesus told him, my time has not come yet. In John chapter 7, verse 30, speaking of the Jews, then they sought to take him, but no man laid hands on him because his hour was not yet come. In John 8:20, when Jesus taught openly in the temple, his enemies again could not seize him, for his hour was not come yet. But then in John chapter 12, verse 23, where we started out, we see a difference in the response. In his response to the Greeks to see him, and Jesus said and answered them, saying, the hour is come. The hour has finally come that the Son of Man should be glorified. That would seem to be a turning point to where the gospel would go out to all folks, the Gentiles. The Jews had rejected him as their Savior, so salvation was going out worldwide to be preached to the whole world, everybody that's out there. But see, the gospel, God's plan for the gospel has his own way. He told us back in John 3:16, see, we knew it all along, or he knew it all along. In John 3:16, he told us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So it was for all of us, all alone. Verse 17 says, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world, that's all of us, through him might be saved. And then in John 9:39, Jesus said, for judgment I am come into this world, that they which see not might see, that's the lost, and they that which see might be made blind. That's the folks that thinks they know it all. And there's a lot of them out there. I hope they repent and turn to the Lord before they die, but I don't, you know, that's between them and God. Personally, I believe that this world is so full. This is my personal belief. This is nobody telling me this. It's so full of religion and rituals that folks have trouble seeing the one and only true God, the man Christ Jesus. I think folks are having trouble seeing him because we go through so many rituals. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 5 says, for there is one man and mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. I believe that we have reached a point in this world, and unfortunately, even here in our own country, where most folks believe that they are not accountable to any higher authority other than what they see in the mirror every day. Folks, we're reaching that point in this country. The only higher authority they respect is what they see that in the mirror, their face, themselves. You try to witness to them about Jesus Christ and they will shut you off real quick. I don't want to hear that. I don't believe that. I don't want to hear that. They don't have time for that. I guess we shouldn't be surprised at that because the Bible tells us that's going to happen. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3 and 4 says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. Verse number 4 says, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. Let me give you an example of how easy it is for us to get our eyes off Jesus. It's so easy for a Christian to get his eyes off Jesus. Now, this is a story that's in the Bible. It's about some of the really great apostles, yet they were still men. That's Peter, James, and John. In Matthew chapter 17, verse number 1, beginning verse number 1, says, and after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was as white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias talking with them. Then answered Peter. Peter's one of them guys, you know Peter, he don't have to ask him a question for him to answer it. He makes his own questions and answers. So it says, Peter answered, and said unto Jesus, Lord, it is a good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make 3 tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. Now listen to this. While he yet spake, he was still talking. Behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. Verse number 5 tells us that while Peter was still speaking, the voice of God came thundering down. Jesus is my beloved Son. He is your Savior. Hear him. Don't pay attention to all that other stuff. You know, even though we have his word, doesn't it make you wonder how sometimes God, I know God would have to just want to look down and thunder at us at what we do and how we do it. Say, don't do that. I can just imagine. I can hear him wanting to say, Jesus Christ is my Son. Hear ye him. Keep your eyes on him. Be quiet and listen to him. Well, we have a hard time doing that, don't we? Be quiet and listen. But because of the excitement of the events that were unfolding right before their eyes, see, even Peter, James, and John temporarily lost their vision of Jesus Christ. Jesus was no longer their focus. Moses and Elias was. And God, while he was speaking, says, pretty well, shut up and listen to me. That's my Son right there. That's who you need to listen to. See, we get our eyes off Jesus because of the worldly things. Everything that goes on around us draws our attention, draws our focus. That's the goal of the worldly folks around us. Let's be honest, and also true for a lot of Christians, they do the same thing. They go, oh, look at that. And they're getting their eyes off of Jesus and looking at the worldly things. They suck you in. Anything but Jesus is what the world wants to give you. As Christians, we must focus on Jesus Christ. He is our Savior. We grow spiritually by feeding on his word. We grow in Christ from the inside out. He feeds us from the inside out. That's the way we grow. We cannot live like a shallow or a rootless tumbleweed that just rolls around with the wind, just whichever way the wind blows. It just rolls around. We must keep our eyes on Jesus and focus on his word, not ours, his word, and grow deep roots so that we can be witnesses to others, so that others might come to know him. The sad truth is a lot of human religious traditions, listen to me, a lot of human religious traditions take the focus off of Jesus. If you go around different churches, you find that out. We must keep our eyes on Jesus. This is what God has told us in verse number 5. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. Forget that other stuff. Hear ye him, what he's trying to tell you. There are sometimes so many traditional legalistic rituals in some of our worship services that by the time folks get through with them, they missed out on seeing Jesus. It's time to go. I mean, our hour's up. We got to go. Folks, that truly happens in a lot of our churches. And I'm not talking about any kind of denomination. I'm talking about our churches, all of them. Keep your eyes on Jesus. The problem seems to be that folks seem to love a doctrine or a ritual more than they do Jesus Christ. That's what was happening over here at the transfiguration. They got their eyes off Jesus, got them on the humans. Well, actually, them two folks is already in heaven. I mean, why would you want to build them anything? They've got everything they'd ever want. So, you know, it didn't make a whole lot of sense. And God said, hey, that's my son. Listen to him. He can tell you what you need to know. There are so many false doctrines and false teachers out there today that I don't know where they come from. Somebody's hatching them out. I guess it's the devil. I don't know. But maybe they just got lost in their ways. I don't know. But I've heard folks say, well, at least they're teaching something. Boy, I hate to hear that. Seriously, I hear that. Well, at least they're teaching something. Let me tell you the plain truth about that. Wrong teaching leads to wrong living. And wrong living leads to the devil's hell. So, no, it doesn't make a difference. It does make an extreme difference is what people teaches you. Listen for the word. Listen for what God tells us. We must keep our eyes on Jesus Christ and follow the truths of the scriptures. All wisdom and knowledge are in Christ. There's nothing's ever going to surprise him. He knows it all. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse number 8, Paul said, I besought the Lord thrice. Now listen to this. And listen to the answer he got. Verse number 9 says, and he said unto me, speaking of the Lord, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Are we going to have trials and troubles? We're going to have aches and pains? Yeah, we are. But keep our eyes on the Lord. He still loves us. He knows about it. He knows what we're doing. Colossians chapter 2, verse number 8 says, be aware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of the world, that's principles, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And you are complete in him, which is the head of all principalities and powers. I want you to understand, folks, that the world killed Jesus Christ. God didn't do it. The world, the sinner, killed Jesus Christ. But guess what? He arose again. He defeated death, hell, and the grave. Went up to heaven, sits on the right hand of the Father as our advocate, as our attorney. Now, folks, you can't beat that. Why? Because he loves you. Real Christianity is rooted in Jesus Christ, nothing else. His strength comes from his word and is his word. It's amazing, isn't it? It comes from his word and it is his word. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is what? Death. But the gift of God is what? Eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You shouldn't be able to quote them. Romans 5:8 says, but God what? Commendeth his love toward us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I want you to know that we have to be willing to say we would see Jesus. What a text, what a statement. We would see Jesus. I pray that everybody in this room right here has seen Jesus. If they haven't, then I would love to show them Jesus before they leave here. Let me open a book and show you Jesus. We all need to say we would see Jesus, and then we need to keep our eyes on him. Don't let the world suck it back off of him, and they'll do it every day. Romans 10:9-10 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, which we've already went over, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and what? With the mouth confession is made unto salvation. We must keep our eyes on Jesus, our faith in him, until he returns. He is our all in all. Don't let the world pull you away from him. And it's happening every day, somewhere every day. Now, you know, I don't know what's going on in our country. I do know what's going on. I don't know why it's going on. It's going on because the Lord's letting it go on, but I don't know why the Lord's letting it go on. So I could go on with that all day. But, you know, we're living in strange times in this country. And I pray that everything turns out right. We'll be still going until our great kids and grandkids are still going. I pray that happens. But if it don't, folks, I'm telling you, God's still in control. And God's still taking care of us, whatever happens. And He loves us. He'll never forsake us. He said He would. Let's pray. Father, we do love You and we thank You. Lord, we thank You for Your word, Your grace, and Your mercy. Lord, without it, I don't know where we would be. But Father, we know that You love us and You care for us and You want us to serve You. Father, I pray that anybody within the sound of my voice, whether it be in this building right here or on TV or on the video or wherever it may be, Father, that they will come to know You before it's too late. If they need help, let them call me, dear Lord. Let them talk to me. The number will be on the screen, and I'd be glad to talk to them and show them how they can be saved and know that they've got eternal heaven with Jesus Christ. In Jesus' precious name we ask. Amen. Brother David Shaw, he's done a good job, isn't he? He's going to come sing for us now.
And if you live anywhere around here, you'd surely like to have some rain, wouldn't you? And you know that God is the one that makes it rain, right? Let me tell you a story here about some rain. About 5,000 years ago, old Noah built an ark. For God had said it's gonna rain, the sky was getting dark. The animals had passed inside, the scoffers standing round. Asked Noah if he thought he'd sail his vessel on dry ground. Then Noah pulled a gangplank in, God did shut the door. The sky drew black, the lightning flashed, and the thunder it did roar. My, didn't it rain? My, didn't it rain? It poured for 40 days and nights. The water covered the mountain heights. My, didn't it rain? My, didn't it rain? The ark, it sailed right out of sight. My, didn't it rain? When Moses went across the Nile to call on Pharaoh, the king of Egypt said, I'll never let those people go. To hold a harum-scarum camp out in the wilderness, to propagate your doctrine of a so-called holiness. Then Moses said to Aaron, let us magnify our God. He stepped out on the riverbank and raised aloft his rod. My, didn't it rain? My, didn't it rain? The locusts, frogs, and lice and flies came pouring out of the blackened skies. My, didn't it rain? My, didn't it rain? It made old Pharaoh bat his eyes. My, didn't it rain? When Ahab reigned in Israel back in the long ago, the drought was on, they had no rain for 40 months or so. Then Ahab went to eat and drink, Elijah went to pray. They said to him, it is no use, don't fool your time away. Then soon a small dark cloud was seen, less than half an hour. Said Elijah, get your parasols, there's gonna be a shower. My, didn't it rain? My, didn't it rain? The skies grew black, the storm it broke. Ahab knew it was no joke. My, didn't it rain? My, didn't it rain? He took no cloak, so he got soaked. My, didn't it rain? Right. Many times I'm tried and tested as I travel day by day. Oft I meet with pain and sorrow, and there's trouble in the way. But I have the sweet assurance that my soul, Lord, will lead, and in Him there is strength for every need. Oh, His grace is sufficient for me. and His love is abundant and free. And what joy fills my soul just to know that His grace is sufficient for me. When the tempter brings confusion and I don't know what to do, on my knees I turn to Jesus, for I know He'll see me through. Then despair is changed to victory, every doubt just melts away, and in Him there is strength for every day. Oh, His grace is sufficient for me, and His love is abundant and free. And what joy fills my soul just to know that His grace is sufficient for me. Yes, His grace is sufficient for me.
His grace is sufficient. I like this song. Just heard it a few times, but I like it.
I'll have a new song over in glory. I'll sing it while the ages roll. How I love to sing Amazing Grace. No sweeter song I know. But I love to tell, love lifted me, how He came and made me whole. I'll have a new song over in glory, a song the angels cannot sing. And for a million years, I'll tell the story. I have been redeemed. We'll sing glad, happy praises while the ages roll. Then we'll take a stroll right down the streets of purest gold. I'll have a new song over in glory. I'll sing it while the ages roll. I can almost hear that melody ringing out across life's sea. Voices of my friends so dear to me blend in sweetest harmony. I'll have a new song over in glory, a song the angels cannot sing. And for a million years, I'll tell a story. I have been redeemed. We'll sing glad, happy praises while the ages roll. Then we'll take a stroll right down the streets of purest gold. I'll have a new song over in glory. I'll sing it while the ages roll.
New song. I have about three songs here that I'd like to share with you about three different groups of people. One of them is about fathers, one's about mothers and grandmothers, and one's about young people. I mean, you don't hear these songs in church, but they send a message straight to the heart of dads and granddad, mothers and grandmothers, and young people. So here's the first one.
Child arrived just the other day, came into the world in the usual way, but there were planes to catch and bills to pay. He learned to walk while I was away, and he was talking for I knew it, and as he grew he'd say, I'm gonna be like you, Dad, you know I'm gonna be like you.
and the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, little boy blue and the man in the moon. When you're coming home, Dad, I don't know when we'll get together then. You know we'll have a good time then. My son turned 10 just the other day. Said, thanks for the ball, Dad. Come on, let's play. Can you teach me to throw? I said, not today. I got lots to do. He said, that's okay. And he walked away, but his smile never did. Said, I'm gonna be like him, yeah. You know I'm gonna be like him. He came home from college just the other day, so much like a man, I just had to say, son, I'm proud of you, can you sit for a while? Shook his head and he said with a smile, what I'd really like, Dad, is to borrow the car keys. See you later, can I have them, please? And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, little boy blue and the man in the moon. When you're coming home, son, I don't know when we'll get together then, Dad. You know we'll have a good time then. Now I've retired, my son moved away. I called him up just the other day. Said I'd like to see you if you don't mind. He said I'd love to, Dad, if I could find the time. My new job's a hassle and the kids got the flu, but it's nice talking to you, Dad. Sure nice talking to you. As I hung up the phone, it occurred to me he'd grown up just like me. My boy was just like me. And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, little boy blue and the man in the moon. When you're coming home, son, I don't know when we'll get together then, Dad. You know we'll have a good time then. So dads, take time with your kids, okay? This song was written back in 1932, and every once in a while there's a revival of it. But it has to do with moms and grandmothers. You may have heard it. Sitting alone in an old rocking chair, I saw an old mother with silvery hair. She seemed so neglected by those who should care. Rocking alone in an old rocking chair. Her hands were all calloused, wrinkled and old. A life of hard work was a story they told. And I thought of angels when I saw her there, rocking alone in an old rocking chair. Bless her old heart, do you think she'd complain? Though life had been bitter, she'd live it again and carry the cross that was more than her share, rocking alone in an old rocking chair. It wouldn't take much to gladden her heart, just some small remembrance on somebody's part. A letter would brighten her empty life there, rocking alone in an old rocking chair. I know some kids in an orphan's home who think they'd own heaven if she was their own. They'd never be willing to let her sit there, rocking alone in an old rocking chair. I look at her and I think, what a shame. The ones who've forgotten she loves just the same. And I think of angels when I see her there, rocking alone in an old rocking chair. Remember that song? Way back. Well, in the last 3 weeks, I have preached the funerals for two young men. Both of them were drug addicts. I don't know what took their lives, whether it was intentional or accidental. But pay attention to the words of this song. Let me see. Might ought to jack that up a little bit. There's a man across the hall who sits staring at the floor. He thinks he's Hank Williams. Hear him singing through the door. There's a girl in 203 who stops by to visit me, and she talks about the songs and the star that she should be. There are a lot of special people staying in or passing through, and for one thing or another, they're committed to Parkview. Now, Parkview is an institution down by Nashville where a lot of drug addicts check in. There's a girl in 307 coming down on Thorazine, and a superstar's ex-drummer trying to kick Benzedrine. There's a boy just down below me who's the son of some well-known. He was brought in by his mother 'cause his daddy's always gone. There's the one from down on Broadway and a few quite well-to-do who have withdrawn from the rat race and committed to Parkview. There's a girl who rides above me loud enough to wake the dead. They don't know what she's taken that has scrambled up her head. There's a writer and a singer that have tried and tried and tried. They just brought him in this morning and attempted suicide. They're those who never made it, those who did but now are through. Some came for their own choosing, some committed to Parkview. They wake us about 6:30, just before the morning meal. And while they're taking blood pressure, they ask me how I feel. And I always say, fantastic, there ain't nothing wrong with me. Then they give me my injection, and I go right back to sleep. And my days are kind of foggy, and my nights are dreamy too. But they're taking good care of me. I'm committed to Parkview. It's sad what happens to our young people today. Let me remind you of a story, shall I tell it once more? 'Twas a wicked king, burning fire, and three Hebrew boys. Now the king had formed an idol, shining image of gold. The three refused to bow, so the story goes on. How they cast them in the fire, and how they numbered them again. Does my vision fail me? There's an unaccounted man. There was a fourth man walking in the midst of the fire, likened to the living Son of God. Behold, he has freed the Hebrew three and walks where feet of men have never trod. For I see Shadrach walking in the midst of the furnace, Meshach strolling while the flames were rolling, and Abednego I see. That makes up the three, but there's a fourth man walking. Who is he? You say you're walking in the fire and it's burning your feet. I know one who'll walk beside you. Lord, his presence is sweet. Even though the fire is raging, flames of doubt leaping high, just take a look and you'll find he's standing there by your side. Always there in time of trouble, with deliverance in his hand. I think I know exactly who that fourth man is. there was a fourth man walking in the midst of the fire, likened to the living Son of God. Behold, he has freed Hebrews 3 and walks where feet of men have never trod. For I see Shadrach walking in the midst of the furnace, Meshach strolling while the flames were rolling, and Abednego I see that makes up the three. But there's a fourth man walking. Who is he? Yes, there's a fourth man walking. Who is he? Fourth man walking. Everybody's gonna have religion in glory. Everybody's gonna be singing a story. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Oh, glory, hallelujah, brother. There's a reckoning coming in the morning. Better get you ready, cause I'm giving you a warning. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Now listen, everybody, I'm a-talking to you. The Lord is the only one to carry you through. Better get you ready, cause I'm telling you why. The Lord is coming from his throne on high. Going down the valley, going one by one. Gonna be rewarded for the things we've done. How you gonna feel about the things you say on that judgment day? Everybody's gonna have religion and glory. Everybody's gonna be singing a story. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Oh, glory, hallelujah. But there's a reckoning coming in the morning. Better get you ready, cause I'm giving you a warning. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Now get your Holy Bible in the back of the book. The book of Revelation is the place to look. If you understand it, and you can if you try, the Lord is coming from his throne on high. Reading in the Bible on the things he said. Said he's coming back again to raise the dead. Are you going to be among the chosen few? Will you make it through? Everybody's gonna have religion and glory. Everybody's gonna be singing a story. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Brother, there's a reckoning coming in the morning. Better get you ready, cause I'm giving you a warning. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time up there. Wonderful time up there. Favorite song of mine called Jesus on the Main Line. You know, back in the old days, had one telephone line. There might have been two or three, maybe five or six on the party line. But Jesus has a main line to everyone. Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Call him up and tell him what you want. You can call him up, tell him what you want. Call him up, tell him what you want. Call him up, tell him what you want. Call him up and tell him what you want. His line is never busy. You can tell him what you want. His line is never busy. You can tell him what you want. His line